So, hi everyone, and welcome to the start of our lecture on financial decision making under uncertainty. And it's the last module before the mid half of the course. So, financial decision making under uncertainty, which was our last module, discussed the key concepts we would be needing throughout the course, which are the concept of consumption smoothing, the ability to borrow, the ability to lend, and so on. But as we know, when we make decisions, it's often under conditions of uncertainty. That is, we don't know all the information out there. There's a lot of variables or conditions that could change or that are dynamic and that don't remain given or known to each and every consumer. There could be some people who know more than us, some people who know less than us. So there's this information asymmetry that could be present too. And that level of uncertainty precludes a lot of our analysis with regards to financial decision-making, especially when we're dealing with financial securities, which are generally more random and more uncertain than a lot of things. So what's the motivation behind, you know, this part of the course? Well, as I said, everything we've done so far has dealt with certain outcomes. That is, in the last module, we assumed that we knew the endowments and the endowments were given for each period. And we know the interest rates and the rate of return on each investment, right? So we know exactly what each investment would pan out. Now, while that may be true for some financial securities such as bonds or just deposits in general, there are a lot of financial securities that do not adhere to some certain outcome. And that's because most of finance is about dealing with risk and uncertainty. And that should be inherent in our tackling of the world of finance. Financial values based on future cash flows are uncertain for the most part. They're uncertain. And probability theory in general will help us understand the set of outcomes and the likelihood of that particular outcome occurring, right? So we have that sort of basis. We can use probability theory to guide us in our journey towards uncovering financial decision-making under conditions of uncertainty. So let's talk about choice under uncertainty. So a principal ingredient of the alternative theories of asset valuation is an understanding of the determinants of the demand for various for securities of various risk classes. Okay, so that's some key term here, demand, right? Demand, again, has something to do, of course, with how we price securities and, in essence, how we value sort of securities. And when we sort of think of the notion of demand, well, why do people demand financial securities in the first place? Well, individuals demand securities in exchange for current purchasing power. So we spend our current purchasing power to purchase financial securities in an attempt to smooth out consumption over time. That is to redistribute income across time and across different states of nature. So across time is more direct on consumption smoothing. You want to make sure that your standard of living is slight gradually increasing across time. But across states of nature is maybe something new to us. When we say a state of nature, it's a state of the world. So you could have a state of the world that is very favorable. Market conditions are good, no recession, low unemployment, good and booming stock market, and so on. But you could also have a state of nature that's the exact opposite, a state of nature in recession, low economic growth, high unemployment, and so on. So there could be different states of nature. And in general, you're not sure what state of nature the world will be in tomorrow. You know, and these things fluctuate over time. So that sort of demanding for financial securities, trying to redistribute income across time, it's a reflection of consumption smoothing, which we've been discussing so far, and a risk reallocation function central to the financial markets. Oftentimes, because when we're dealing with uncertainty, we're dealing with, of course, risk, right? And what a person would want to do is they would try to get different financial instruments and diversify their portfolio such that they can minimize risk, especially if they're not a person who's willing to take larger risks. And it has a lot of whole economy systemic implications, which we'll discuss towards the end of the course. But from a micro perspective, from their own perspective, a person may not be willing to have so much risk. And in general, they would want to sort of smoothen out or to diversify things such that that can be reduced. Now, under uncertainty, the objects of choice are typically no longer consumption bundles, like we had in under certainty. So we had consumption bundles of different consumption streams, but in reality, they're vectors of state contingent future money payoffs. Now, what do you mean by that, right? In essence, each vector is a financial asset that we may purchase or some investment. And the vector would be the different potential outcomes of that investment at different states of nature. So what would be the value of this investment in a good investment environment? What would be the value of this investment in a low investment environment? That's sort of how you should picture it. Now, of course, as we said, the term risk of an investment refers to the uncertainty in future cash flow. You're uncertain about how the cash flow will be a couple of periods from now or even tomorrow, right? Because these things are random and they're in general moving and they're dynamic. So the risk of an investment refers to this uncertainty to which the investment represents ownership. You own the investment, but in general, what happens with the investment is generally uncertain to you. Depending on the state of the world, whether it's a good state of the world, a favorable condition or an unfavorable condition, we may receive different payments and possibly much lower payments than in some states than others. So if the conditions are favorable, we have a good outcome, a high payoff. But if the conditions are not favorable, the state is not favorable, then we have a low payoff, right? And that knowing which state to switch, that's generally random. And knowing the exact outcome is random. And in this context, the assets associated cash flow in any future period is some random variable, right? And this is where the statistics comes in. We have a random variable here, hence we're gonna be dealing with concepts of statistics. Therefore, under financial uncertainty, the choice set is the set of all conceivable investments, alternative investments, leading to different possible income levels and hence ultimately different consumption bundles. So this is a huge sort of possibility frontier, right? So you're dealing with which investment should you get? What are the possible outcomes if you use these investments? And because of these are the outcomes, which are the investments that you should get? How would you allocate them? How would you diversify them? How would you minimize your risk? How would you sort of maximize or minimize payoffs based on your preferences and so on? There's so many things to consider. So in order to first pin down how we're, because of course our goal is to guide the consumer, how will we guide this consumer in this world that's generally uncertain? How will he or she navigate through this world of uncertainty? What basis will he or she use on making decisions, on making financial decisions, because he or she has this goal to smoothen out consumption over time? Well, it requires a stable criterion. Okay, so how do consumers make choices among different alternative investments? It requires some stable criterion that underlie the order of preference defined over different alternative investments when choices made by individuals are considered economically sensible. That stable criterion is not so easy to find. And what we'll do in this course is essentially propose different criterions that could potentially answer that question of how do we make decisions or how does a consumer make decisions under periods or under conditions of uncertainty. So that's what we're going to be tackling in the next few weeks, right? So in making choices, so again, the central question is how do people make choices in the presence of uncertainty and risk? Well, to do that, first, there is a need to rank order alternative investments. You need to know which investment you would prefer over another. So do I prefer this investment given that it could be like this or could be like this over this investment given that it could be like this or could be like that? So you need to be able to rank different alternative investment opportunities that all of them are generally uncertain. So you're not sure whether that investment is really going to pay off that, right? And because of the uncertainty that's there, so there's a need to rank order alternative investments that have uncertain money payoffs or outcomes according to an individual's preferences. And you need a stable criterion underlying the preference ordering, which is defined over different investments if choices are to be considered as rational. So again, we assume that the individual in this case, of course, is a rational individual. Okay, so someone who adheres to the axioms of consumer preferences we described before. So the choice in general, so the first thing that comes to mind in the world of finance, of course, is a choice based on the maximization of expected value. So if you're given with a couple of investment opportunities, typically the one that would be there is the expected value of the investment or the expected payoff of the investment. And that's the first thing that people generally look at. It's the most obvious solution. So the most common assertion is that choices should be made to maximize expected values or expected returns, right? So according to this criterion, so the expected value proposition is actually that stable, one of the potential stable criterions we could be looking for. Although in the world of economics, as we'll know later on, this is not the one that we typically use. So according to the expected value criterion, okay, if an individual faces two situations in which the outcomes or monetary payoffs are uncertain, he or she will choose the situation or the investment with the higher expected value of the outcome. So say you had you had two competing investments, and then you were given with a probability that it would be a good investment and a bad investment, and then what it would turn up being, then you just calculate for the expected value and then choose whichever is higher. That's the expected value criterion. So similarly, if an individual faces a situation that leads to uncertain outcomes, he or she should be willing to pay the expected value of the outcomes, i.e. the value of the uncertain outcome equals the expected value of its outcomes. We'll delve into more of that under that, in the next video. So this is our last slide for this particular video. So let's just go through it. Early contributors to decision-making under uncertainty were generally the gamblers. So the pioneering people behind this financial sort of model are gamblers, because they would gamble. So they would try to picture or try to think in their head what could be their expected payoff if they choose to do this particular move in a game. And they believe that comparing expected values of outcome alone would work as a decision rule. But we're going to discuss in the next video that this isn't the case, and that expected value, that just using the expected value, is a myopic representation of how to go about making decisions. And it's something that we should move on past from, and that we should really understand why we're not using this. So that criterion, this expected value criterion, is not that stable of a criterion. And moving forward, as we go to the other videos, we're going to tackle as to why this is the case and present a couple of alternatives that we think are far more stable than it. So thank you for watching this video. Thank you for your attention. And in the next video, we're going to discuss more on decision-making under uncertainty. Thank you for sticking around, and I'll see you in the next video. Thank you very much.